So next, the speaker is Shri Pravin Subba Nanjappaji. For him, so I heartily welcome him. So he is an IT consultant with over 2 decades of industry experience. His passion is for both modern technology and ancient Vedic technology. So if not for software, he would have been a Vedic Indologist. His trust with Bhakti Yoga started around 15 years ago. So he has a wonderful experiences. So I request Pravinji to share his concepts and his views. So over to Pravinji. Thank you.
Om Gurur Brahma, Gurur Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwaraha, Guru Sakshat Parabrahma, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. I offer obeisances to Guru Shri Yogi Devraji, Vishwanath Guruji, Guruma, all the Rotarians, participants, parents, well-wishers, and the compassionate cosmos who has given me this opportunity. Thank you. So a very good afternoon and a happy Independence Day to you. I believe that we all, you know, being part of the ancient culture Bharat, we have a special responsibility, an obligation towards the world to disseminate, to spread the wisdom, the knowledge which has been articulated by our Sadgurus, Acharyas, Masters and Yogis. And I'm a seeker in the field of yoga, and I would like to present my topic, Bhakti Yoga and its relationship with mind. Okay. So this is how I've structured my session for today. We'll start with deconstructing mind yoga. What is mind? What is yoga? What is bhakti? What is the correlation, jugalbandi, the duet between mind and bhakti yoga? Some of the experiences, and then we will talk about the benefits, and we'll conclude with a small experiment. Okay. So bhakti means devotion or love. Yoga is union. So bhakti yoga is nothing but uniting with Supreme God through love and devotion. As per Gita, it says, Mai eva mana adatsva, mai buddhim niveshaya, nivasishyasi mai eva atta urdham na samshayaha. Just fix your mind upon me, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and engage all your intelligence in me. Thus you will live in me always without a doubt. So this is what the Bhagavad Gita says. We also have another scripture, which actually it's a Narada, Narada Pancharatra, Sarvopadi Vinur Muktam Tat Paratvena Nirmalam Hrushikena Hrushikesha Sevana Bhaktir Uchyate. It means engage all your senses in the service of the Lord. When the spirit soul renders such service to the Supreme Lord, there are going to be two side effects, or rather benefits. One is freed from all the material designations, and one's senses are purified simply by being employed in the service of the Lord. So bhakti yoga, and you know, we also have Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Raja Yoga. Now, all these are authorized forms of yoga in the earlier sessions. Yogi Devraji also spoke of them, and so did Vishwanath Guruji. So, Karma Yoga is all about executing your prescribed duties without attachment. Jnana Yoga is all about, using your intellect to develop wisdom. Raja Yoga is training your mind with lot of discipline. Hatha yoga is like having a physical temperament. Compared to all of this, Bhakti yoga it doesn't demand too much. All it asks is unalloyed love and devotion to the God. You don't need to be having a high intellect, high physically intensive work. So, and in fact, when you practice Bhakti yoga, it is said that Jnana will itself be revealed to you. So, let's now look at what are the different forms of Bhakti. There are 9 types of Bhakti. Okay. These are called as Navavida Bhaktis in a Sanatana Dharma. In the Eastern and the Western civilization, in the Western cultures, they may follow some of it and some of them could be popular. And, when we talk about the delivering of Bhakti Yoga, it could be attributed towards both Suguna Brahma or Nirguna Brahma. I mean, it could be towards a personalized form of Lord or a formless. And the beauty of this Bhakti Yoga is you have 9 different ways of executing. They need not be followed in any sequence. If you want to stick to one particular, you stick to it. If you want to do a couple of them, do it. If you want to do all of them, you're welcome. You can either do it sequentially or parallel. You can do it orderly or without order. So that's the beauty of what has been passed on to us by our acharyas. So let's go one by one. Shravanam, it's all about hearing the names and glories of the Bhagwan. We would have seen, right? You know, we experience bliss by listening to Ramakatha or it could be Satyanarayana Katha. So this is all about listening. Kirtanam, chanting, singing the glories of the Lord. And our Bharat is blessed with such wonderful saints like Annamacharya, Purandaradasa, Kanakadasa, who have created a treasure trove of kirtanams. Smaranam, in its simplest form, it is just thinking of God. Very simple. Padasevanam is serving the Bhagwan's feet. Those who are fortunate to have physical association of Bhagwan can do so. Some of them can actually do it thinking their Sadguru is the Bhagwan. Archanam, this is all about following the rituals, like, you know, ringing the bell, offering prasadam, decorating the deity on the altar, fasting. And this can be done not just in temple, but also at home. Okay, Vandanam. So Vandanam is just offering obeisance to Bhagwan. You can do it with simply folding your hands or a Shashtanga Namaskara. And when you actually fold your hands, you know, it activates some of the energy centers, which would in turn, make you feel more happy internally. Dasyam, this is serving the Bhagwan, treating him as a servant. And the wonderful example we have is Lord Hanuman, how he treats Lord Ram. Sakyam is another rasa where you treat the Lord as your friend and develop intimate relationship. The perfect example again is the relationship between Arjuna and Lord Krishna. Atma Nivedanam, it is total unconditional surrender of oneself to the Bhagwan. Okay. So, you would have seen many of these concepts. Guruma covered it and so did Guruji. I will quickly summarize it and then bring in the relevance to my main topic. So mind, as you all have now known, it's a source of thoughts, emotions, imagination, storehouse of all your memory, perception. It is a form of energy. It is invisible. You cannot really measure it, but however, the states of mind can be measured through EEG. And, we have conscious, subconscious, unconscious, and superconscious. Conscious is where, your wakeful state. Subconscious is swapna or dream state. Unconscious is where you're in a deep sleep. It's also called as sushupti. Now, while the modern science has been predominantly focusing on the top three, you have super conscious where your EEGs are, you know, very low from three to about zero. It is the highest self, Turiya. And a lot of research still needs to be happened in the superconscious state. And this is also the state where our yogis operate out in terms of doing sadhanas. And, you know, I would like to talk about two significant concepts. So Sigmund Freud, right, he has mentioned about, he has articulated that the childhood experiences form the basis of our life as being adults. And also, it would lead to our adjustment to life. Now, Jiddu Krishnamurti actually took this to, he elevated this further and he came up with free mind concept. What he says is, every experience in our life is imprinted deeply on our mind. And it will crystallize in our life later on. And every action we do, whether it's a positive or negative, it actually comes back to us in the form of a habit. And, you know, it does not allow us to grow a free mind. You know, when a habit is formed and when you want to break a new, when you want to take corrective action, by trying to break the new habit, you are creating a new habit. So how do we come out of this cyclical loop of entangling our mind and resulting in creating habits? And he beautifully explains saying that we have to understand it and overcome it, overcome from this cycle. And this is acquired through great, great awareness, alertness, and patience. And we have to look inwards to become free thinkers and find new freedom. So our yogis and masters are free thinkers, and they have done this by turning inwards. So these are some of the concepts of mind, and in our own Vedic wisdom, it is defined as antakarana. It is a thinking instrument, mano, buddhi, chitta, ahankara. Mano is, you know, the mind which actually creates your thoughts. Now, buddhi is our intellect. We can control mind. Actually, control is a very heavy word. You can manipulate your mind using intellect or jnana. Chitta is a storehouse of all the impressions. Ahankara is our identity. And many a times we may have a false identity. I'll talk about that in the next few slides. And there's a very beautiful shloka from Amrita Bindu which says, Mana eva manushyanam karanam bandhu mokshayoho. Bandaha visaya saktam muktaye nirvisayam smutam. Mind alone is the causage of bondage and freedom. When mind is observed in the sense object, it causes bondage. And when the same mind, if it is detached from sense objects, it leads to liberation. Okay. So being a software professional, you know, I have tried to make an attempt to articulate my viewpoints in what is a mind, right? I believe mind is a highly sophisticated software. And just like your software systems has unlimited terabytes, gigabytes of memory storage, our mind has unlimited stories, memory storage across multiple lives, past lives. And in the software, there's a continuous evolution. You know, the earlier computers were small. It used to actually fill in the whole room. Now it has been reduced as a small processor, which embeds in a mobile phone. And there's a lot of version firmware upgrades which happens. Machine learning, just like this, just like the technology world, our mind is also evolving continuously. I'll give you one example. In 1954, there was an athlete. His name was Roger Bannister. Roger Bannister ran a 1 mile in 4 minutes. Running a mile in 4 minutes was considered as inhuman, and there were a lot of theories which said why human body is not designed to do it, and so on and so forth. But in 1954, when he actually did it, within a year, there were half a dozen athletes who actually broke it, which means that the whole, you know, the belief system, the self-limiting belief is, you know, it is destroyed, and you have elevated, you have evolved to the next level. And then automatic healing, you know, every time your system crashes, all you do is you reboot your machine, and then something magic happens and your laptop is fine, your machine is fine. Likewise, you know, our mind will actually do automatic healing when we go into our sushupta or a much more, you know, deeper conscious levels. We will undergo healing, and Guru Ma has actually spoken about this in her session. And network of consciousness. Now, this is my favorite part. You know, you can see the diagram out here. I mean, we all now, we cannot survive without internet, which is just a couple of decades old. But beyond that, I believe there is a network of consciousness. It is as old as gravity, or, you know, beyond that. And I have tried to build a metaphor here. See, in our technology world, you have servers and client machines, and client machines are all, it could be a laptop, it could be a dumb terminal, and there will be some amount of local processing computation which happens. But they're all powered by the server, and you also have cloud. So likewise, each of us can be compared to these terminals, you know, a mobile phone or a printer, and we all have our own individual processing consciousness. But beyond this, you have a super consciousness, a collective consciousness, which acts like a cloud, like a 5G. And it is this apparatus which will enable each of us to communicate with others, you know, individually. Telepathy is a classic example. You know, we'll be in a position to communicate our emotions. And the law of attraction is also, you know, the basis of this. It's on this. And likewise, you know, just like we upload images, we can like, post on the Facebook, we can comment. All of it can also happen at a network of consciousness level. So if the collective consciousness is like 5G cloud, we are more like edge devices. Okay. Yes, now this is a very important slide. This is where I made an attempt to explain how Bhakti Yoga and the mind actually interact with each other. I would really like to thank Dr. Yogi Devraji, Arun Kumarji, Venu Gopaji. You know, their book, Pearls of Vedic Wisdom, is an inspiration for me to create this block diagram. So, you know, there are three elements. You have an outer world, which is where a lot of things are happening, and name, nama, rupa, form, kala, time coordinates, place, desha. See, this is the outer world, and we actually perceive whatever happens in the outer world. We perceive it through our five senses, which is your gnanendriyas, and again, you know, your form, sound, touch, smell, taste. These are the five qualities. Now, what happens is, in a typical, an average person who is not in Bhakti Yoga, what happens to him? A person who is in Bhakti Yoga, what happens to him? Let us do a comparative analysis. A person who is in an average person, his mind is filled with thousands of thoughts. And whatever he sees, it could be on the social media, newspaper, he is receiving all of these information through all of his senses. There's a lot of clutter which is getting created. Now, compare this with a person who is in Bhakti Yoga. A person in Bhakti Yoga will accept only information related to God. He will name, you know, in the form, he will look at only his mind is focused only towards the form of the God. He will listen only to the stories, leelas of the God. Kala, he will spend most of his time remembering of the God. Desha, he will spend most of his time traveling, visiting temples, and so on. And all other thoughts he ignores and rejects such triggers. So the number of clutter is, he doesn't have any clutter. It's all one-minded, single thought. Okay. Next part is mind. Okay. So mind has personality, ego, Arishadvarga, Panchakleshas. And, you know, all of them will actually feed the inner world. So personality is shaped by environment, you know, what kind of a network we are in, what kind of education we have undergone, what has been our past experiences, what has been our, tendency to do things, and prarabdha karma. You know, prarabdha karma is a portion of karma which has been assigned for the current life from the larger superset of karmas. In a person who is not in Bhakti Yoga, let us see how this happens. First and foremost, the person will have a false identity, ego, right? The person identifies himself as, you know, I'm a software engineer, or, you know, I'm a crorepati. The identity is linked to wealth, societal status, all of these which are actually fleeting. And even when that event is passed, the person clings on to it. If a person is an IAS officer, even after the retirement, he will say, I'm an ex-IAS officer. So this is one problem. And then what happens is, when the person, whatever information he receives, right, as I said, he goes through lot of, his mind is easily agitated because the amount of the volume of information which is being received, and further the kind of education which he gets, the environment, it could be a very highly, competitive environment, and where he's forced to take some actions which is against his values. So all at the end of the day, all of it will result in creating, in the inner world of the person, object, topic, incident, there's a lot of thoughts which gets into his samskaras, and most of them are materialistic and negative in nature, which acts against him. Now, the same situation, a person practicing Bhakti Yoga, first and foremost, ego. The person will identify himself as a soul, as an energy soul, and a servant of the Lord or a devotee of a Lord. And then the environment, the yogi, the bhakti yogi will always be in an environment of satsanga, education. He will always be trying to educate himself of how to be a better human being, how to serve the Lord, and experiences. Even if he undergoes, if he has some problems in life, like karmas, right? He would treat karma, prarabdha karma, as a mercy of the Lord, and he will not suffer. He will still undergo the problem. He may still be undergoing a physical pain or whatsoever. But by doing all of this, what really happens is his mind is purified, and the whole aspect of Arishadvarga and Panchaklesha, he is bypassing it by unconditional surrender to the deity. Therefore, what happens is his inner world is full of clarity, unlike clutter in the non-yogi. And his inner world is becoming a temple, because he's always thinking about the Lord, the Leelas, the stories, and thereby enjoying his relationship with the deity. Okay. So now let's go to the benefits. The number one benefit is reduction in the number of thoughts. We are not talking about a blank state or a thoughtless. We are talking about a single thought, which is again towards the deity. It triggers happy hormones such as oxytocin, dopamine, serotonin, endorphins. So, you know, Dr. Navenji actually spoke about this beautifully. He said illness to wellness. So this relates to it. And it changes the vibrations and transitions from a conscious state to subconscious state. You know, when they start doing kirtanam or any other Navavida Bhakti, they will achieve a deeper level of trance and tranquility. And then, you know, it cultivates healthy samskaras, which will help towards seeking liberation. And constant practice will lead to their subconscious reprogramming to become a really legendary personality, because a bhakti yogi will be practicing gratitude. He will thank Almighty for giving him yet another day to serve him, to serve the society. Forgiveness. He will forgive others, and he'll also forgive himself. Acceptance. So when all of this is practiced in Bhakti Yoga, it's not just he, it's not just self, but his whole family. I think Dr. Navinji spoke of mirroring, I don't know what he called, but there's a mirroring concept. So it actually is becoming like it cascades to his surroundings also. Okay. Discussing the Bhakti Yoga is incomplete without referring to experiences of devotees. And so what happens is we have several cases where the devotees have experienced paranormal phenomena, healing, and miracles, because it cannot be measured in the modern scientific angle. We have several such incidents. I'll cover a few of them. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, you know, he was always confused as a madman because he would be so much intoxicated in the divinity, worshipping Kali, he would lose his sense in terms of what's happening around him. And at one point in time, you know, he was bitten by a king cobra. And had it been any other person, within a minute or two, the person would have been succumbed. But Sri Ramakrishna, he felt that, you know, it is none other than Goddess Kali who has come in the form of a serpent, maybe trying to pass on some message. He was in such a samadhi state that, you know, the venom did not have any impact on him. Bhakta Kumbhara, there was a popular movie in Kannada and other South Indian languages. So he was so much mesmerized in the thought of Vitala, and, you know, when he was, kneading the sand to form the pot, he did not even notice that his own son came under the feet and he had trampled to death. But again, by the mercy of his deity, the child was brought to life. Sadashiva Brahmendra Saraswati, he was a self-realized soul. He would look completely inwards, and he would not even bother about what's happening around him. And there was one incident where he was roaming around without dress, as he was passing by the Sultan's palace, the queens actually got scared and they shouted. The gods came immediately and they chopped off his hand. But the Saraswati ji did not feel the pain. He did not even notice that his arm is gone. He walked as if nothing had happened. When the Sultan learned about it, he came running, he apologized. At that time only he realized that his arm is missing. And all he did was he just included it, and like a Lego block, it kind of fixed to his body. So these are some of the, you know, paranormal experiences which happens when a person is in a super consciousness level. Okay, so this is an interesting topic. See, Bhakti Yoga can be practiced with knowledge, without knowledge, by rationalists. The outcomes are different. If a person practices it with knowledge, surely the person, you know, has potential to experience samadhi, turiya state, blissful state, and definitely medium to full trance. The reason is, in this case, the individuals are able to appreciate the relationship between their self and the deity. They could relate themselves, you know, they may feel that either their Lord Krishna is their child, you know, they will have that personal loving relationship. Or sometimes they can feel that Goddess Durga is their mother, or Ayappa is their brother, or Krishna is their friend. So when they have these, when they put in these personal relationship, they can very easily get into the higher emotional, positive emotional state. They'll express the emotions with the deity, and they can experience bliss without knowledge. In such case, they can experience deep level of happiness and medium to full trance. It really depends on the intensity. See, because in such case, what will happen is, they will still get the results, but the bliss of personal association with the self and the deity, they are not able to understand and they are not able to appreciate. It is more like transaction. You know, you ask me to do it, I will probably, you know, walk. I will probably do some duties which are assigned to me, and I'm entitled to get some results. Rationalists, they will they can experience a deeper level of fulfillment, meaning, but not necessarily they'll get into a trance. See, because they will be channelizing all their energies in terms of saying, okay, I believe in doing Janaseva. I'm a Desha Bhakti, you know, Bhakti towards not Lord, but towards the country and the society and so on and so forth. So these are the different ways of different variations how we can practice Bhakti Yoga. Okay. So now we will do some amount of a small practical. As you all know, as I said, Kirtanam is one of the Navavida Bhaktis, and Tejashwini Praveen will be leading the Kirtanam. It will go for about 5 minutes.
Namaste. Kirtanam. Kirtanam is chanting the glories of Lord, and it is one of the best ways to getting near to Him. And it is the reflection of what we have learned about God and chanting what we have heard. I would request you all to sit in a comfortable position. Now, assess your mental state. How are you feeling? Are you feeling joyful, disturbed, sleepy, or bored? Rate your mental wellness score on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being the lowest and 10 being the highest level of happiness. If possible, please write it down. Now, we will do Kirtanam, chanting. Close your eyes. Take a deep breath. Inhale. Exhale. Inhale completely. And exhale. Inhale. And exhale. Observe your body from top of your head to your toes. Gently relax. Pay obeisance to your favorite deity. Connect to the divine and completely surrender to your favorite deity. Now, I am going to chant Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. You can choose any mantra of your favorite deity. Please mute your microphone, chant with me aloud, and let your ears listen to every word you're chanting and feel the vibration of the transcendental words as you chant. Gently clap your hands while chanting. And try to engage all your senses. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama. Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna. Rama,
Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Keep your eyes closed. Peacefully think of the Lord and be in silence for a few moments. Now take a deep breath and breathe out completely. Gently rub your palm and keep it on your eyes and give your face a massage and slowly open your eyes with a big smile. Now I request you to please assess your mental state again. Give a score to your happiness on a scale of 1 to 10. 1 being the lowest and 10 being the highest. Please compare your happiness score before and after the Kirtanam. You will notice an improvement in your mental state, increased tranquility and more relaxed mind. Namaste.
So, in closure, we had Guruji talking about Pratiprasava. Dr. Naveenji spoke about yoga for mental health. Guruma spoke about the mind miracles which happens at the subconscious level. Rekhaji spoke of pranayama and the benefits to the mind and body. And we just concluded Bhakti Yoga. So I would like to offer my heartfelt gratitude again to Yogi Devraji, Vishwanath Guruji, Guruma, all the Rotarians, the participants who have patiently been with us, and the blessings of the cosmos. And thanks again. Thank you so much.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you so much, Praveen sir. It was really a wonderful session with the Bhakti Yoga. So it is one of the easiest form or the way to reach the ultimates. So thank you so much for Praveen sir and madam also. For being with us and sharing their wonderful experiences and the practical part, especially, really wonderful. Thank you so much. So, not but the least, the thing. So, we have done with the speakers today with wonderful sessions, with wonderful knowledge, which they have shared with an abundant of knowledge with their experiences. So, we heartily thank once again for all the speakers. So now I would request our own Rotarian Dr. Yogi Devraj, the chairman of Global Yoga and Meditation Fellowship, Rotary International District 3190. So, and he was also a past president of Rotary Bangalore Global Yoga Club. And he's also a president for Swami Vivekananda Yoga Research and Holistic Health Trust, and a Vice Chancellor for Yoga University of the Americas. So I heartily welcome Dr. Yogi Devraj Guruji to say a few words and his views. So over to Yogi Devraj Guruji.
Thank you. Thank you, Vinay. Friends, it gives me immense pleasure to be with all the scholars who spoke the abundance knowledge. I was all along by listening to each and every scholar, I was thinking, I think we can take these people to many universities across the globe to spread the knowledge of ancient Bharat. Really, I felt myself happy and proud that we are making this effort of preparing this compendium with the great masters, scholars like Dr. Vishwanath Guruji and his complete team. And I also felt and confident that we can really give this series of compendium every year in future to the world as a gift from Bharat, so that we can make the whole world a peaceful place to live. The way in which each and every speaker, the scholars, put up their points, it was so good, it was touching, that a lot of research is possible in Bharat. I am really thankful to the complete team. And also, I request them to be ready so that we can present all these things by June 2022 to the global stage, so that we can plan as our another, probably we are going to have one more international webinar headed by Sri Rajendra Ji of Australia. He's already been well connected to the government of Australia. And we can plan these three presentations. One is Sounds of Pranayama, second is Mind Yoga, and third is Divinity in Yoga. These three things in 108 places in USA. That is his plan, including United Nations and White House. Friends, I feel we are energizing ourselves so that we can give a beautiful gift of knowledge, of wisdom to the whole world through yoga. Mind yoga today is really dealt so well that we can understand the different facets of mind and different facets of yoga, especially bhakti yoga. How it has got effect on mind. And the research, which has been discussed by Dr. Navinji, the way in which each and every one explained it so well, and it's easy to understand, even by the layman. Really thankful to each and every scholar who make this grand success. Without, you know, further thing, actually, I need not tell anything. Already, you have listened to this. And I also thank all the participants who are participating in listening, all these scholars. We also request you to encourage us in all our future programs so that we can do and come with much more bigger programs. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Guruji, for your wonderful views and giving a thanksgiving also for our speakers. So as it's an ending, so I request our Rotarian President Raviji to take over further for the vote of thanks and further process. Vote to Raviji.
Okay. Thank you, Upinay. First of all, I would like to thank each one of you present at this point of time in the conference. The international seminar on Mana Yoga, this was the ideation that we took it up like last 1 year back, and the work had been started around, say, 10 months ago. So I really thank the spearheadingness of Sri Vishwanath Guruji, who is the managing trustee, Spiritual Solution Center, who is a mind coach and also the PLR therapist. To assist with him, I would also like to thank Dr. Naveen Jayaram sir, Guruma Gayatri, Kumari Rekha MC, and Shri Praveen sir to take the sessions today. I know the total team of Spiritual Solutions Center had taken up this work from past 15 days. So I also would like to thank all the people who have been working on this project from past 15 to 20 days. It is our mission and vision under the guidance of Dr. Yogi Devaraj sir, who always tells yoga has to be taken to each and every house. That is Manemaneyallu Yoga and Manamanathallu Yoga. Under that mission, we have taken up these projects. And this is a long-term project that these three papers are to be proposed in Houston, USA in June 2022. The planning is on, and we will be having more information coming across to the people who can be part of our own program. I would like to also thank Dr. Yogi Devaraj sir and also M.K. Nagaraj Rao sir, who had been with us till now to support and also to guide us further. I would also like to thank our own Rotarian Vinay Kumar ji to host from starting till now, and also the support team of Total Rotary Bangalore Global Yoga Club members who have been supportive to us, all 30 to 33 members who have been working tirelessly on taking yoga forward. So I would also like to thank my own home club, the viewers from all parts, not to leave out any viewers at this point of time, and also like to congratulate on this date, that is the 15th August, that is the Independence Day. Rotary per se can be inculcated in any form of the yoga through our club. The fellowship is also there. The chairman for the fellowship is our own Rotarian Dr. Yogi Devaraj sir. So every Sunday 7:30 morning, there will be classes. I request each and every member who have been present over here also to like Rotary Bangalore Global Yoga page on the Facebook. It is adieu without taking the name of our DG, Fazal Mahmood ji, who has been supportive for us, and also the total Rotary team. Thank you one and all to be a part of this seminar or the International Series seminar. And I would like to thank each one of you one more time.